We just give Rafia for all things. You may be seated, Yisrael. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Blessing to be in the presence of the Abba, the Shiva. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You may take your seats, Yisrael, and we do want to extend a great greetings unto you that have joined us here in this Shabbaton gathering in the Beit Yisrael, in the house Yah has elected to seal his name. We can come before our precious Abba and first of all acknowledge his greatness, the power of his redemption unto Yisrael, that we were not purchased with silver or gold, but by the precious dam of Yeshua HaMashiach. And that's why no man is going to be able to chana, to redeem himself in the hour that we're in. I don't care what his labor is, how excellent his speech, his oratorical skills of enlightenment, excitement, his power to debate. But we as the nation of Yisrael, we must walk in the excellence. And simply the tomim, the complete, whole perfection of Yah's Torah. And if we do not find ourselves walking in that display, then woe unto us, irregardless to whom we are, whom one is, then woe unto that one. This is one of the most vilest of repugnant generations that one could ever live in. Because this is a generation that operates in this ovin, the spirit of iniquity. There's a coldness of their nature that they have no love. They think they do. We'll greet you all here in a minute. As I said on last night, Yisrael, one of the most prolific teachers of love was Mr. Eddie Long down here in Georgia. But he raped your sons. And the story is untold of how many sons and your daughters this beast has raped. We have men like T.D. Jakes and Benny Hinn and all of these men. They always talk about love and loving someone. And yet these are the surmises of hell. These are the mercenaries of darkness. They have one allegiance, and that is to hell. It's not to Yah. And of course, the people buy them. And they rape your daughters, because if they were not raping your daughters, they would repudiate it. They rape your daughters and your sons. They defile your wives, and now they're defiling even your husband's wives, because a woman cannot even satisfy this nature that is beyond the control of a beast. But all these men talk love. This young man that butchered 12 people here the other evening. Of course, there is a rosary of superlatives to describe his demeanor. He was kind, he was loving, he was sweet. He was a good boy, as many would say. Yet he was a butchering beast, birth out of hell by the commands of Yah, that he would go forth and kill without a cause. Mr. Zimmerman there in Florida the other day, he was on Mr. Sean Hannity, and he said, quote, they ask him, If you had to do this over again, would you have gotten out of the vehicle? And he said, quote, it was the will of God for me to get out and for this process to go forward, unquote. I believe that. It was the will of his God. A true Hebrew Israelites, they're led by the Ruach, the Spirit. Yoshua said that the Torah that I declare unto you, the words that I speak unto you, they are Ruach and they are Chai. It is Yah that I speak, and the life or the power of that, it is the essence of what life is. You don't know a damn thing about life until you experience the nature of the living Torah. Is this living? I said yesterday, as I was somewhat, not weary, but physically tired because I labor. And as I proceed to get the mail from the carrier on yesterday, this woman, she looks at me, she knows me because she's familiar with my look. She comes here often from Ferry Express. And she says to me, what's wrong? I said, I'm tired. I've been working and laboring this morning. And this was her quote. I know that one. For I arrive, I leave my house at 5 a.m. every morning. And I don't get home until it's 7 p.m. in the evening. That's living. That's life. Even the slaves had a better condition than that. She said every day, where's the time for her children, for her husband? And this is the cruelty what the world has disposed upon us because of our disposition, because what we want to be and pretend what we are. This is what it has granted unto you. It's not even an ebet. It's one thing that an ebet was, it was a slave that had the ability that after a period of time that they were free. They don't free you after 7 years. It takes 40 years now to pay for a damn shack, for what you call a house. They finance cars for 8 years and 10 years. And this stupid generation, and those that think they know Yah, and those that say they love Yah and they love everyone, don't give me that damn love, all right? The Catholic priests and that organization of the utmost whoredom say they love. And Mother Teresa is exude before the nations as this pristine. She was a dirty Jezebel. I guarantee you that. There are those that will get offended. Don't write me with your shallow questions. Stupidity. Yet this is an organization of great charity. And yet the nuns are committing such atrocity of such wickedness. Aborting babies and these pedophilia, homo, nature, men they call priests, praying on your sons and your daughters. But that's love, isn't it? That's love, isn't it? That's what you call love. Well, my imam, my avok taught me love. They taught you a twisted, damnable, pseudo-ficial, homogenized thing you call love. You cannot have love outside of the exterior of the Torah. It is a damn lie. It is an emotion you have. Because if you have the true Achav of Yah, when you sense the nature of Ovon, iniquity in you, you will resist that. You will rise up against it as a warrior. You will not operate in a state of juvenileness. That's the way children are. They like to be right in everything, don't they? Children like to explain themselves, don't they? That's how we are. We want to explain our defensive mode of defense. It's sad. I greet you all that have joined us. Oh, I'm going to preach today. I have some energy. Yoshua's mighty name, our precious ark. It's a hands I Charles there in Los Angeles and the group that's with him. Wherever you're listening, we greet you all. Arak, yeah. Hope there in Jacksonville. How are you, my friend? Arak Lester. In Chicago, Illinois, we greet you all. Our precious friend, Ach Keith. Wherever you're traveling, we greet you as you are on the road. He drives a tractor and trailer truck. And so we greet you, my friend, Arim Oprah, there in the Maryland Eastern Shore area. We greet you all, our friends, Arahot Mariana. May the riches of Yah rest upon you, our friend, Daiwi, there in Indiana. May Yah prosper your hands as you labor in the garden, and may he produce much fruit for your labor to garner and to harvest. There shall be much in the tillage for the days that are ahead. Greetings to you all, whether I call your name or not. I greet you in Yahshua's mighty name. It is one thing that my friend, my Ach Michaya, he always, every Shabbat, he always sends an inspiration to press on, get ready, preacher. And we're ready for the battle. I always respond that I will see you all in the Bayat, in the tabernacle, in the house of Almighty Yah. And so we greet you all, our friends, our listeners. We're going to teach today. We're going to preach. We're not going to obfuscate or deny our responsibility and duties. Have you all, I'm quite sure you've heard of that tragedy there in Aurora, Colorado. This man is one that will practice medicine on your mind. He was a neuroscience PhD student. And these are the freaks that are prescribing things to your body. And you think that they're wise and they're smart, they're nerdy. And they're twisted as hell. These are the leaders. If you look at some of those in Congress and the Senate and the House of Representatives, you see such distortion. If you have any spiritual depth, you can see it. The singers and all of these. And so here, Hashatan, there must be an offering, because this is a nation that believes in offerings unto their God. They're willing to pursue his agenda. And his agenda is to, first of all, ganab. He is a thief. And he steals. And he robbed you of all of the beauty of the essence. What Yah instructs us according to the Torah. And he comes, Yisrael, to Necha, not Shochath. He comes to destroy, to wipe out everything. And so in his cathedral of darkness, in his synagogue of death, in his temple of offering, he causes one to rise up as though that he has the same mind as the Joker. He was a motley fool. And that was the only one that could get by with any of his juvenile activities. He could go before the king and call him a fat bastard, and they would laugh. He can speak all kind of rhetoric to his wife and cause the processional proceedings or the orgies to begin to take place. He could call her dirty whore, and they would laugh with a roar. He was the only one that was exempt from the king's hand of death. And so here one rises up in the synagogue of hell, the movie house. And no Israelite should ever go into a damnable, twisted, vile, wicked movie house. Is there any truth that is perpetuated in a place like that? Is Batman real? It is fictitious. And if it's fictitious, it's a damn lie. It has no relevance of substance, of truth in it at all. And then the stories they write or they will choreographic, as though that it is something that relates to a true reality in life, there is so much leaven in it that a little leaven destroys the whole concept of what could be conveyed as truth. And so his children are there at midnight at the stroke of the pen. Some waited in line for 3 hours, 4 hours. Some were camped there at the beginning of the day for a damn Batman movie ticket. And they're not cheap. In my days, you could get in the theater for 50 cents. It progressed to $3, and that was extreme. You don't get in these damn dirty whole houses under $25. And Harshawtown is not cheap. And so the theatrics of the event began to be performed in a way that everyone was so amused and excited about a damn lie. Yeshua is the light. And because the mind of man is so dark, there's a hoshach that light cannot even penetrate. You talk about some of the Nubia stars and some of the outer space that even scientists hear, some of their most powerful machinery and lasers and light cannot even penetrate the veneer. That's how dark it is. Then not even the soundness of the testimony of Yeshua would penetrate. So Yah gave them over unto death and hell. You can talk about it any way you want to. You certainly, I would not mock the families who suffered that tremendous agony. But when you sell your babies to hell, you sell them to lies, you sell them to falsehood, what in the hell do you expect? We don't want to be legitimately honest about it. We want to sell people this most despicable, homogenized thing we call affection. And they were hugging, grasping, and you find the heroes and the heroine, those that said that they saw and could have rescued, they helped someone because they have their moment of their superficial Hollywood lights. And believe me, when the bullets began to fly, they all began to run. You understand, they're liars. And so when we as parents sell our children unto darkness, we shape their mind by hell. We teach them lies. We read lies to them that they call fairy. Not just a lying tale, they call a fairy tale. So we read the fairy tale to our children. Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. We teach them lies. Jack and Jill went up the hill to fetch a pail of water. Jack fell down and broke his crown. You see, we can retain that from this infamous mind of even youth. We have no ability to retain anything when it comes to Yah. And so we are the absorbers of all kinds of lies and twisted folly. There's one thing that profoundly stuck out in my mind as a young man. Young and ignorant and still ignorant, but I was ignorant and dumb then. I'm ignorant with some characteristics that I'm shedding the dumbness. And I'll never forget that evangelist Hartsfield, one of the first things he said to me, son, these are the synagogues of hell. I had gone to see Brubaker. I had gone to the movie. And when he began to explain things, I didn't have to ask questions. He said, there is nothing that is more prolific and their tongue of shecher, of lies, than movie stars. He said, in order for you to be an excellent movie star, You must be an exceptional liar. You must know how to lie and be persuasive with your lies. And he said, everything that comes out of those places, it is nothing but to inundate the mind with lies. Who's the father of all lies? So if he did not abide in Torah, in truth, and everything he speaks, the Torah said everything he speaks is a lie. So how do you as a people, an individual, go into the darkness of his enclave and you sit there and allow your mind to be filled with some of the most vilest of wickedness to train you as a mercenary against Yah? You don't have to buy it, and I don't give a damn. It is still the truth. Keep going to your damn houses of whoredom, every kind of vile activity, men with men, faggots kissing faggots, women unfaithful in all of their activity, men. And you sit down and you feed your mind this damn wickedness, you are a damn fool. And you are as wicked as the ones that esteem your heart and make you feel fat. You damn Jezebel. You're a damn vile thing. I don't give a damn who you are. And I'm not going to stop saying, damn this wicked world. You have no time for Yah. That vile thing that would visit us. Why you all don't pray long enough? And this greedy heifer did not even pray. This is how wicked people are. And I laid eyes on her and said, Yah, why did I do that? Why did I allow to come here? It is the truth, son. You're not going to change Mr. Holmes' mind. His activities were carried out by the commands of Yah. And to destroy, no one can destroy the children of Yisrael. No child of Yah, the children of God was in that house. But no child of Yah was there. No true son of Yisrael, no birth. But the Ruach of Yah has gone into to such a damnable, twisted place. No one is going to sit all day and look at something to fill their mind with some of the most vilest and reprehensible activities. Women walk around with their titties out and sex every way that is carried out in a way that there's an expression there. And a man looks at his wife, there is no even excitement, but yet that excites him. It causes his nature to be moved beyond that which is proper and right. You are a damn fool, man. You are a freak, Jezebel. And I don't take a damn word back. Damn you. We're dealing with the very strength and the stronghold of our Leban, our mind. We get angry, we get antsy at Yah. We feed our flesh. We cater to that, and we never refresh our Ruach. So he said, come to my house on the Shabbat, maybe you'll get a little something. You cannot stand in the authority of Yah and call yourself a messenger, and you are doing every kind of vile thing. Damn a movie. I'm glad I never was caught up in no damn mess like that. I was a sports nut, but I like to play it too. Glad I was never caught up in renting damn movies and downloading. It's wicked. It's wrong. It's vile. It's not of Yah. And all those that carry out the road, you can see them. They're whores and dogs and fags. And you let a fag pump that mess in your mind, you're sick. And that's a fact. Maybe the numbers will all drop today. That's all right. I'm all right with that. And that's the truth. I will not sell out for a damn dollar. Four pair of Stacy Adam alligator shoes. I won't sell out for that. I won't. I never have. And I could have gone the way of all of these damn pigs and lived fat as any man. Because I don't see many out there that have proficient oratory skills and how to be persuasive. I recall as a young student in class, I was taking public speaking. And my instructor said, Dave Roberts, that's why I didn't take it. You must take voice dictation. You have the ability to captivate the audience with your vocal pitch and the range of your speech. You have the ability to do that. Well, that sounds well, doesn't it? I want Yah by the words of the Ruach in my mouth to lead us into the bosom of Yah, that we embrace Him and not this damn wicked world. This is just the beginning. This is not the beginning. There are great troubles and trials. Can I say this to us, Yisrael? We are part of one of the most wicked nations. I was looking this morning. I should have brought it. Because I will research certain things that I believe that are valuable and pertinent to the very order of what things we see being manifest. And I was looking this morning at the wars that this nation from its conception, even when it began its birth there in Britain, these vicious beasts, these swines of death, and killing, and robbing, assaulting. Yet this little incident that just happened in Belarus with four of what we call the Israeli citizen being destroyed, the first person they blamed it on, you know who they did. Or they call Hezbollah, but they said it's the Iranians. So they want to devastate that nation and steal their oil. Just like they want to steal the lithium out of Afghan. You tell me the bankers and the world leaders of power and those on Wall Street, J.P. Morgan, that lost $7 billion the other day, and they're robbing the poor people. I said to my Ishan Oximion, I said, all this is relevant. You can read it in the daily papers when we purchase them. I said, you know, Yisrael, I say, what a strange thing that they will tell you this is the country of opportunity, but it's the country of death and destruction. I said, out of 350 million people, 50% of the people, 100 less rounded off, 160 million people, those that can be accounted for can't be, they own less than 1% of the total wealth in this nation. And I remember when the wealth in this nation, the total wealth of all its assets, were around $5 to $6 trillion. Now, because of the hyperinflation, it is nearly $14 trillion. When you combine the whole wealth of the world, it's only worth about, in dollar numeric value, only around $76 trillion. And yet, 150 plus million people share 1% of that $14 million value. And we think that we are blessed because you have a damn raggedy car and some shack that the termites are going to eat it up. They rob the minds of the people. And because they have caused terror on the babies of Afghanistan and Iraq, and they are ready to go as Mr. Obama there in Somalia, dropping his drones and his bombs. Hell, why do you fight them with that? When the best they have is the AK-47, a Russian Mykolchilok, an old weapon that they used in the Vietnam War. And you dropping drones on them bombs? You coward. The fire is coming back on this whore. I will show you something today. The fire of your wrath upon your children. You even, you ever save your children, save their minds. You train them up in the ways of the Torah that they should go. And the Torah says, when they are old, they shall not. That's the confirmation. If you train them right, yes, they shall not depart. If you train them up in the ways of Yah, and the way that they should halak, the process of their footstep, they shall not turn away from Yah. We haven't trained them because we don't give a damn. We have not trained our own selves, our own minds. We're full of this fleshly lust that is so wicked. There are times that I could be a recluse, but I know that Yah has put things in my heart. I cannot be a recluse. I must open it up. I don't want to be by myself. We as parents, you have so much damn trash in you, such wickedness, you don't even realize it. You wonder why my son is acting that way, my daughter, because that damn mess that is in you, you are not even faithful with you. We have not trained them. My mother didn't train me. Well, she taught me to love. How in the hell could she teach me to love when there were a trove of men in and out of our house? How in the hell could she teach me what love was when you would hear these groanings and grotesque sounds early on Saturday morning, and how your heart would sink? You tell me that's love? And as a child, I would find my places to cry and say, Yah, if you ever give me children, I will never allow them, Yah. I will never let my children be subject to such things that are so cruel. And even though I was wicked, that was things that Yah kept me back from. Making babies and just having these kinds of affairs with young girls that I could have. Yet He kept me from those things. He kept me from that. And I was as wicked as any man. So how could she teach me the tenets of love? You at home square the mother, rule the father, usurp authority. She couldn't teach you a damn thing about love. And you have the same nature today. You rise up. You're denigrating her. I deal with factuality and truth. I don't try to hide a damn thing. You can't hide it. That doesn't make me any less than any of you. It doesn't make my mother any less than any of your mothers. But it's just the truth. And that's what she did. And it was not to my advantage. Because a death. And as the old one would say, thank Yah for Yahshua HaMashiach. Though the storms keep on raging in my life, and sometimes it's hard to tell the night from day. Boom, boom, boom. Yet there's tikvah that lies within. It is reassuring. Sure it is. As I keep my eyes upon the distant shore, I know He will lead me to that precious place. That's all right. And if the storms don't cease, I like the way, why don't you all sing that, all right? She can sing it well. I'm not a singer, I'm a preacher. Hallelujah. And all those things that we as a nation of people, we have been taught a superficial thing of love. That's why when one speaks to us with any kind of correction, we rise up. And the first characteristic of our juvenileness is our anger, our disapproval of that. You know you don't have love because you have ovon in you, iniquity. And you will find that you will have this sense of coldness. You ever been in a place around one that call himself an Akan Ho, and you know that there's something cold there? All right then. And they're cold. Yoshua loved Yisrael. And through all that love, they still forsook him. They betrayed him. And yet we won't betray ourselves and stand up for what is right. So I had to be taught love. And I'm being taught love every day. That's why I don't tell nobody I love them. I want my deeds and my actions, my faithfulness, my loyalty. Let me tell you this little story that I'm going to preach. When I went out the other day to retrieve the wood square for our winter burning, and as I got to Carolina Pallets, the establishment, it was an old man. And immediately when I saw him, my eyes, as I shared it with my Isha and the Ark, my eyes were attracted to this old man. He's looking at me and I'm looking at him. And of course, the person that loads me, he literally has this huge front-end loader, and he puts between 11 and 13 scoops on the truck. And so when I drive that, you know, is heavy. I'm very careful. She's heavy. She sits down like she's sitting down. And so as I saw this old man, I knew he was an elderly man, but not as old as he was. He was 83 years old. And so I get out of the truck and I park the truck and I walk over to him and say, "How are you doing, my friend?" He said, "Well, I'm doing fine, trying to get enough wood to burn because everything is so expensive." So I began to load his truck. He was 83 years old. He could not move that fast. And I wasn't going to leave until his truck was tightly fitted and loaded. So I had to stack every square. It was hard too. So I began to load his truck. We began to talk. He told me of his life. He said that I was somewhat inquisitive. He says, "I'm 83 years old, born in 1930 or something." He told me when he was born. I said, "My, what a great privilege for me to be able to assist in any way." I was excited. I was. So he says, I said, "Do you have brothers?" He said, "I have one. My mother had twins, James and John. She named us." He said she was young when she married, and as soon as we were born, she died. My mother died. Never seen her, never met her. I say, "Wow, that's very intriguing story." He said, I said, "Do you have children?" He said, "Oh yes, I have five." He said, "I married, and my wife bared me five children. The last set I had was a set of twins. And when the set twins were birthed, she died." So, timer. He says to me, "And I never married again. I raised my children. I took care of them. I built a little house. I'm still living in that house in Oaksboro." He says, "My mother died with twins. My wife died. And I did not want to put my children under the care of anyone. And I took care of all of them. I raised them, fed them, and I clothed them. I didn't want anyone else over my babies. And I brought them up. And I'm 83 years old now." And so when I finished his truck, he gave me a jewel. Of course, his language, you all know how he talk. He says that the Most High, may he put a star in your crown for what you've done today. I said, "My friend, I don't know if he'll do that, and I'm not expecting him to do that, to put a star in my crown, but I know one thing. I've been crowned with a star today to be able to assist you and to help you. That's my star. And so after I did all that, now I must straighten out the big truck now that is sawdust and piled up to here. So I must climb up the truck, and it's hot. And so the old man, he walks over to me. He has this Pepsi Cola bottle. You can tell the water was ice cold. Only thing I regret I didn't do is to get down and to receive the water. He walks over to me and says, some water for you. Well, the thing that flourished in my mind, if one gives a Sadiq man, a cup of water in the name of a Sadiq man, he shall in no wise lose his reward. And I said to him, my friend, thank you, but I have plenty of water. My mistake. I should have drank from his cup that he offered unto me. What a great blessing to be able just to, I may never see him again. So I said to Oxymeon in the ark, I'm not going to get any more wood for another month to make sure that if he comes, there's plenty. Because I said I was greedy and I was going to get every square, and I was. But I won't get them all. But to make sure that there's wood for this old man, 83 years old. And one other question I asked him, I said, old man, he was a very handsome man. I said to him, oh man, if I live to be 80, I would love to be as handsome as you. He was a handsome man. And I said, how is it that you have lived this long and you're so handsome? He said, hard work and plenty of water. Hard work. So we work out our own nefesh, yoshak, our soul salvation, with yare, with fear. And Yira, with fear and trembling. And then we drink of the living water of how Shema I am. If I never see him again, I doubt if I will. But what a beautiful day. And that excited me more than coming home and finding an offering that was $5,000. There are many times I don't discuss things with my Isha, but I had to tell her that. I came in house. You got to hear this. Ah, what a beautiful event. So precious. I enjoyed it. His grandmother was born in slavery, and his mother was on the precipice of the freeing of slaves. He was a man that you knew he was not educated in the sense what we call education. Pierre Ruach, that was so beautiful, handsome too, and strong looking. I said to my Isha, you know, you would think that an old man like that would be flabby and all that. When he took off his shirt, because he brought his shirt to change his clothes, I said, man, that old man look hard. I'm looking at him like, oh man. He said, hard work, son. So I plan to work hard until I die. We're going to just drop. I'd rather do like, what's his name on the story? And what's his name? Matthew. I'd rather drop in the field. That's me. I'd rather die in the field. I don't want to die on the bed. He reminded me of the old man down here, the Yahweh's assembly. I remember going past his field one day. He was out there. That old man was 85, 86, nearly 90. Those were the years that he could have kept up with. When his father died, he said he was 115 years old. It was every bit 100 degrees, and I went to visit this old man. He's dead now. And I go by this garden, rose as long as from here. And this is no exaggeration to those beds over there. And I see, I'm not talking about these here, the ones on the way over there. I see this old man hoeing. And beside him is a chair. He would take the chair and set it yonder, as they would say. He would go back there and hoe. Till he get yonder, and he would sit down in the chair. And I'm watching him. Of course, I had on my nicer duds, and I certainly didn't want to get out hot as it was, but I got out of the car. He didn't even know who I was. His mind was somewhat lucid. I said, how you doing, old man? How you doing, friend? He will always talk like that. I said, what are you doing out here, Timer? Well, I'm just weeding the garden. I grow my garden. I got watermelons. I got beans. I got squash. I say, you got a lot of weeding, old timer. Yes, sir, I'm going to get it done, though. Well, I know you're going to get it done now because I'm here. So I said, give me that hoe, man. And I let him talk the whole time. And I weeded that garden. Took a long time. And then he asked me now, who are you? Are you Chalamet's boy? I said, I'm the preacher down the road here. Oh, Pastor Robert, ooh, Elder. That's how he responded. Last time, really, he came here for one tabernacle. And then I didn't even know he had deceased, and he died. And these old men, they lived long lives, but they worked hard. That old man worked. He raised his own food. You go to his house, he had guineas and chickens and goats. He had everything. He raised his own food. He was only getting about $500 a month. Wasn't much money. And yet he had abundance. We greet you all again. I know that it is somewhat of a path that I've taken this morning, but that's all right. All these things are valuable and important. This process, as we process the truth of Yah, not through a mind that is carnal, but through the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach. And as we do that, we will see growth, Yisrael. I want to begin again. I know that I started here in Gilyana, Revelation 13 and verse 17, but I am in the process of teaching the entire chapter of Revelation Gilyana 13. Yisrael, you can search the entire Sefer, the writing, the scroll, the documents of Gilyana. You will find nothing that has to do with any kind of sustainable living according to the flesh. It is all about what we call worship, the Shechah, the prostrate bowing, the submissiveness unto one that has the authority and the power that we are obligated to, and that we show our allegiance unto that one. It is not about you buying fishes and loaves. It is not about that. It is the power of him that is able to redeem you or to buy you back from the very clutches of hell and darkness. That's what this book is all about, Yisrael. And we see that you cannot buy yourself back. You cannot redeem yourself. There was one by the name of Yaakov. He had insidiously robbed and stole the birthright of Esau. And he knew that Esau was a murderous, powerful man. And he knew the time of reckoning had come. And so he began to send ways of offerings unto Esau to abate, to slow down the process, until he laid hold on to Yah, unto the Melech, the messenger of Yah. And he would not turn him loose until the power of the Torah was exercised in his bosom, that he trusted and believed Yah. And Yah says to give you a sure sign, he caused him to limp with a hollow in his thigh. We cannot walk this race by ourselves. You're not going to accomplish the feat in your segregated little world. And as he sent the riches of his wealth, that did not cause Esau to slow his progress. He rode like a warrior. He rode to destroy him. It was only by the power of Yah that he was redeemed from under the death-crushing blows of Esau. Why? Because the promises unto Yisrael, they were in Yaakov. He promised unto Abraham, but there were no 12 sons. He promised that even unto Yitzchak, but there were not 12 sons. It was only that man that he shall fight for Yisra'iah. And yet the trove of all of his riches and blessings, he could not buy or redeem himself. It was only Yah that redeemed him. It was only Yah that caused him to be rescued. And that same force shall rise up again, is established in the earth to bring down the power of the testimony of Yah. It is the mind of Issa. And he has entrenched himself among the interior, the nations of the Goem, the nations of the earth. And he has blended himself very carefully. A hunter must be careful in blending themselves for the season. You cannot go out there hunting during the winter when there are no leaves and you got on green camouflage, can you? Neither can you go in the woods during the summer when you're hunting and have on brown camouflage. So he has camouflaged himself well in the extreme of all things, intellectually. He has camouflaged himself spiritually. He has camouflaged himself governmentally, mercantile, all of that, Yisra'iah. And we must understand that. So this is not about you sustaining your life. If we lose our lives for Yahshua HaMashiach, we have gained our lives. You're not going to sustain yourself. This is not about buying pork chop. This is not about buying your penny candy. This is not about buying your potato chips and your vegan patties. It is not about that. It is the power to demonstrate that one can purchase themselves or free themselves from the power that is Ogan Agan. I want to begin here in the book of Gileana, Revelation 13, 17. Yah instructs us that there shall be such a calamity of such dearth and death in the land that no man, even with all of the excellence of his might, his strength, of all of his assurance, he will not be able, even his words will not satisfy him. Even the strength of his speech unto him, as one would say, motivate yourself, there will be no motivations at all. And so the time shall be so bleak. It shall be so chaotic. It shall be a chasm of death everywhere. Unless Yah is on your side, then woe unto you. There shall be no power to be redeemed from under even the crushing blows of oppression. And the demonic forces of hell shall press upon your mind as they're doing today. They're pressing upon your mind, Yisra'iah. Every kind of vile thing, concepts and thoughts that you never thought that could even penetrate even your mind is being inundated by that. Things that you that's even not a part of your nature, your character, and yet you're being tried by that. He's seeking the place of stronghold, just an entrance into your mind. And he knows he has that when there is a performance. Once there is a performance of that action, that activity, he knows he has you. And he lies dormant. He said, leave it there. Leave it there. When we need for this to be enacted, we know what it takes. As Arzokhin Yaramaya brought out to us, there are fish that burrow down into the earth, catfish and different fish, their species. It is almost like a hibernation of death. And yet when the monsoon, the rain season come, they flourish, they grow, they lay eggs. The ground become parsh and inhabitable. And yet when it comes for that time, then you see the flourishing of that species when the rain began to fall, the created environment for that thing to produce. And so it is with the powers of hell. That there's an environment that is created that caters to one thing. And that is the corrupt mind that is enmity against Yah. To be carnal-minded is enmity against Yah. It's not subject to the Torah of Yah. And neither indeed can it ever be subject unto the Torah of Yah. So it functions in activities and things that are dishonorable unto Yah and despise the Torah of Yah. And the time will be so chaotic that no friend can comfort a friend. No one can console anyone. There will be no confidence in brothers or sisters or no one. One shall be exhausted. There will be nothing. You cry unto Yah and you say, as I read from Yeshua last night, when Hashatan, as he came before Yah, he says, look at the children of the earth. They only worship you for what they want. When they get it, then they forsake you. They turn their back on you. Look at Abraham. All these years, you gave him a son. When he had no son, he hasn't offered nothing. But when the child was born, he offered up everything. He gave much. You didn't hear that because you didn't listen, all right? He gave up everything. He presented all this to you. And look at his son, Yitzchak. He has offered you a damn thing. And Yah said, but have you considered my servant Abraham? Have you considered him? Because the day will come when I ask for a son, he will give me a son. He will give me everything he got. He will offer unto me that which is appropriate and proper. He will give it all for me. He will surrender all for me. Everything. Now we're that people that we are the birth lineage of Abraham. Have we given all unto Yah, or we are retaining, holding back certain things that we find to be valuable unto us? We possess nothing of value, Yisrael. We have no substance at all. Our substance is vile. It is full of stench. There is no tough thing, no excellent thing that dwells in the fleshly content of man. There's nothing of any value in our flesh. It stinks. It is rotten. It is vile. It is easily corrupted. That's why we must bathe in the dam of Yahshua continuously. I want to begin here. There's much to this teaching today because there are some metaphors and some patterns I want to establish. And I cannot do it in a sound bite. It takes Torah understanding, and scripture must be revealed that you see all the pieces tied in together. Again here in Gilyana Revelation chapter 13, verse 17. We're in this time of government that no man will be able to kana. You will not be able to create, even in your own conscience, the very image, the very authority, the power of Yah. You cannot even redeem yourself. There will be no knowledge that you can access, because it's one thing that a fool hates. He hates knowledge. A fool despises knowledge. And one of the most despicable knowledge of a fool is his own folly, his own stupidity, his own limitations. He despised that. That's why you can say anything to an ignorant man, a man that is unlearned, he is ready to debate. His expressions is not of one of a wise man. It is always one that is full of folly and foolishness. His frown, his expression, the brows of that man. You see no wisdom in that damn man. It's stupid. So no man is going to be able to come now. With a system and a world so destroyed and desolate, there will be no place for you to buy Kentucky Fried Chicken. You're not worrying about some kind of vegan patties, and that's the truth. So there will be no substance to buy. And if it's according to all the speculation of all of these lying, fictitious thumpers, the Lahays and all of these boys today that go on the rhetoric, what they've heard of these men concerning the mark of this beast, the mark of the system, the mind, the legion of the system, that everything is going to be chaotically destroyed. There will be no commerce with the ship sailing abroad from the sea. There will be no imports. There will be no export because the whole system shall be brought down to nothing. So what are you going to buy? And with the nuclear fallout of such devastation and death, what will grow in the ground? We must have the fruit The Ruach of Yah. That's why when Yahshua is coming, he's coming for the abundance. And this shall be the sustainer of life, of our strength, in the midst of great trials and tribulation. We shall hold fast unto the testimony of Yahshua HaMashiach. We shall be the ones that keep the Torah of Yah. And we will love not our lives unto the death, that we die for him. And that's the truth, Yisrael. So no man is going to give any kind of accreditation unto his own ability and say, I purchased myself from the grips of hell. You will not be able to do that. You will not be able to say you are redeemed yourself, Yisrael. We have been purchased by the dam of Yahshua HaMashiach. And there is no other alternative to that. Don't worry about that. You'll pay attention to me. Hallelujah. And that no man might be able to kana, to buy, to redeem himself, to have the power to buy or to redeem himself. You will not have the ability to acquire the knowledge of Almighty Yah. Wisdom is the principal thing. But in all our getting, we need to get understanding. What is understanding? How to process the wisdom, the experience of Yah, how to process it in its legitimacy of activities concerning the Torah. You will not be able to acquire knowledge. Jehu said, this is a nation, a generation that is forever learning, but it's never able to come to the da'at, to discern. That's what da'at is, the knowledge. Da'at is the ability to discern, the ability to recognize what is Torah. And they're never able to come to the knowledge, the da'at of Torah. They will never be able to assess that. And in this hour, you're not going to be able to assess the knowledge of Torah. You're not going to be, you're going to have all the books. I know we had a very beautiful Ach here at one season. He said they're going to take all the books and they're going to take all the scripture. Hell, it makes no difference when they take that. It's not in us. It's not in our Lebab. It's not in the mind of this corrupt, wicked nation. It's not there, Yisrael. So no man would be able to buy. He will not be able to kana, or either he will be able to ga'al, to sell. Save he that have the mark. No man will be able to redeem himself from the very blows of hell, whereby he believes that there is some kind of relief from the very agony of this great oppression that has befallen him. Unless you have a mind that is in full allegiance with the powers of hell. Unless you have the birth and the mark of Esav. Did not Yah put Cain a sign upon him? And so there shall be an insignia in the mind of this generation that will show their allegiance. Has nothing to do with you buying food. Nothing at all. Has nothing with you trying to put silver back. And this is your mean of bartering. What are you going to buy? You going to buy you an AK-47? You going to buy weapons to defend you? Your shoe is my defense. Damn this wicked government. They can come and burn us down like they did David Koresh. Damn this wicked government and the governments of the world. They're all corrupt and they're all wicked. They are all about the commands of hell. There's only one true government, and that is one that walks and operates under the allegiance of the Torah of Almighty Yah. I don't give a damn if it's capitalistic. I don't care if it's communistic. They're all totalitarianism. They're all the same. HaShatan said to Yahshua, as he showed him all the kingdoms of the world, and he said, all this has been delivered unto me. It's mine, and you know it. And there is not one damn thing you can do, Yahshua, you know, because I have a time and a season. He says, deliver unto me, and whomsoever I give it, nor fun to bestow it upon the, to grant it, it is in my power to do it. And you know it. And you know there is nothing you can do. It is the power of his Torah that governs. It is the power of that Torah that gives us the right mentality and the true Ruach to walk in the light of Yah. You can't be governed any other way. Damn the Constitution. It's a corrupt writing of wicked men, vile, corrupt, wicked men. Did not Was not this book written by men whereby the Ruach HaKodesh moved upon them? They were set apart men. They were Kadosh men. They were Kadosh men. Hallelujah. And even all that Satan HaShatan said to Yah, he said, have you considered Abraham? For he is a Tomim. He is perfect. He is an upright man. He hasn't brought you offerings. He hasn't offered up unto you what is acceptable. And you tell me he is perfect because Yah says he's perfect. Yah says he's upright. Yah says that he is mine. So no man is going to be able to buy nor sell unless you have an allegiance, a mind and a heart that has abandoned all that which is faithful unto Yah. And we find that today in all of these little vile religious sects. We got these Naha, as Yah calls them, boys. Everyone get a little bit of information they think they have, and they began to develop their own little tributaries. They think that they are a river of water. They are a sea of living substance that flow from them. You ought to hear some of the things that people write and ask me. I don't even answer their silly juvenile questions, because I know it's the question of a boy. Wise man, he always comprehend by hearing. And he shuts his damn mouth. And he understand, Yisrael. This is a generation that is corrupt. They defy Yah. They defy their own damn gods. They defy those that say that they are their leaders. And that is the truth, Yisrael. Yah's going to bring this whore down. He's going to bring this American snake down. It's not going to be Mr. Barack Hussein Obama. He did call himself a mutt, didn't he? No pedigree. Do you know of any dog that has true pedigree? They all are a combination of mixture of peace. At least he was honest. Well, he's taken down America, you dumb jackass. You tell me you built something 237 years old and a little mutt in 3 years has brought it down? You got a sick damn nation then. Come out of her, my people. You got a sick damn nation. You tell me a little jackass like that because you're a Harvard degree grad, a law student, in 3 years, he destroyed all of your construct, all of your pillars of principles and power. You are some silly people. And you voted for him. I did not. Hallelujah. Can I move on? You almost got to be careful what you say, because if you say that, damn Mr. Obama, I'm not saying that, you will almost have the Secret Service out here. He said, damn Mr. Obama. I'm not going to say that. Hallelujah. But I know he's Yah's man. And he raised them up to expose this damn wickedness of this whore. That's right. He established every king. Well, that's not true. Well, did he raise up Pharaoh of Mizraim? For what purpose? To get honor on his name. He's going to bring this dirty slut down to the gates of hell. She stole. She has been the very strength of the power of darkness. She has butchered. She has stole, she has robbed, she has killed the babies of other nations. She bombed Afghanistan, hell, she went there in Vietnam and destroyed her life. And the wicked French and their damn greedy masquerading as a group of damn hoarding dogs. She burned that nation down to hell with her Agent Orange. And 70% of the population is under 30 years old. She burned the nation and robbed the nation and killed the nation and stole from that nation. And you tell me it's not going to happen in your nation that you so love, damn America. Now Secret Service can come and see me on that one. Damn America. Damn America. Well, if you don't like it, get out, then tell me where to go, beast. Isn't it amazing that we have the freedom of speech and the Constitution, but when the speech is not popular to the ears, well, you should say that the Muslims should be able to be allowed. They can't do that, but yet you have the right to say what you want to, you beast. You liar. Your Constitution is not worth a damn thing. Not even worth the paper it was written on. Hallelujah. I intend to make you angry. I got a Constitution. It's a book. And you can't go around this book. Hallelujah. There was an individual that when I was in Charlotte, when I lived there, he was a lawyer. His name was Attorney Brooks. And he was a very charming lawyer. It is one thing about the practicing of law. They will tell you, you can bend the truth, you can twist it, you can contort it, you can wrestle with it, but just don't break the truth or the truth of the letter. You can take the Constitution, you can bend it, you can twist it, you can transform it, you can conform it to whatever you want to. It's not worth the damn paper was written on, Yisrael. And that's a fact. My allegiance is unto the kingdom, and I fight for the kingdom of Yah. I fight for Yisrael, the nation, not that little stretch of land that we call Israel there. I don't fight for that. I don't fight for that. Yah is going to fight for his house, his people. I stand to defend his truth. You understand? I don't fight for that. I don't fight for America. Well, you're not patriotic. Well, you know, some of these men that call themselves patriots, patriotic, they've never served in the military. They've never. They've never even served in the military. I think that's somewhat cowardly, don't you think so? They never served. They never served in the military. They never even gone. They can't say that they're Vietnam era veterans. They can't say that. The ones that are my age that was, they were cowards and ran. And their mom and daddy had money to keep them out of the military. They're cowards, the Hannitys and the Rush Limbaughs and all of those pigs. And that's the truth. Hallelujah. There's a fellow there in Scotland, he doesn't like the way I talk. It doesn't make any difference whether he liked the way I talk or not. And the thing of it is, he still comes back to our site to see what I'm saying. I told him, you are a jackass and a coward. Because if you don't like what I'm saying, then why do you even visit our sites? Why do you check up on me? You think that I will let you stop me from expressing things the way I do? You're wrong. No man is going to do that. He can enhance me by teaching me things and showing me things that are relevant in this process. But you're not going to alter that. No man is going to be able to buy or to sell. No man will have the power to redeem himself. No man will be able to buy back. That's why we must redeem the time that we're in. We must buy back, Yisrael. We have sinned. We have fallen short of the beauty of Yah, and you're not going to be able to do it in that hour. We're in an hour right now whereby it exacts everything from you to even operate in the Ruach of Yah. We have this self-righteous generation of individuals. And yet they're superficial in all of their activities. Their lives are not the value of snake's poop. They're hypocritical. They're full of lies. They have no in-depth wisdom of the ways of Yah, the Torah of Yah. They have sound bites. I had a man to write me the other day, do you know this, this, and that? I said, send me the information. If it's relevant, I'll read it. Now, he writes to me as though that he got this profound wisdom to share with me. He sends me this information that he had read. Not even two complete paragraphs. I didn't even read it. You send me that. And you have exacted from that enough to confront someone with. You get one verse and you're going to confront someone with that. That's how stupid this generation is. Can I move on? I want to be God. I want to hear this here. I want you to hear this in Revelation chapter 12, verse 3. I want to go back now. Revelation chapter 12, verse 3. This is the time that we're in. There is only one thing. There's the challenge of the kingdom of Yah. And we know that the kingdom of Yah dwells within the bosom of Yisrael. And we see this in Revelation chapter 12, verse 3. We see the powers of hell. We see the mindset that is raised up against Yah, the power of his HaMashiach, Yeshua HaMashiach. And it is a challenge for one thing, and that is to operate in the pure worship of Yah. That's what the whole thing is about, Yisrael. That's why there was a Torah given, there was a Levitical order as to how things should be carried out. That's what this is all about. It's not about you buying biscuits. And the true lineage of Yisrael, yeah, he's going to feed them. He's done it one time, he's going to do it again. He fed us in the wilderness, he's going to feed us again. That's why he said to Yisrael, when you go unto the land of to the mountain, he said, don't take the water of Esav, you buy it, that he can hold no charge to you. Don't allow this wicked world to give you anything free. That they cannot charge you, the powers of hell can charge you. I had the prominent representative of South Carolina come on these grounds one day. And of course, he just got caught with some female in his vehicle drunk. And he looks at me and says, Reach, you want some money? I can get you some. Of course, you all know how I am. Of course, I got right up in his face and I said, I don't want one damn brown penny. You can give away all the money you want to. You can sit about there in the middle of the road. But don't come on these grounds. We don't want a damn thing from this government. We're not beggars. Someone need to teach you on the spirit of a beg and see how vile it is before Yah. We're not beggars. Not begging for a damn thing. You give all the free money you want to out there. But not here. We will not take one dime. This is the challenge of hell. To see if our Abba is able. See, is he able to sustain us? This shall be a time of great agony. The social system will be destroyed. It's already destroyed. You got faggots that kiss like men and women. You got butch bulldogger. You got effeminate men have no strength. You got these rambunctious bulldogger spirit women that run the house. The husbands are weak as duck water. He has no power to command his house. And yet he's not trying to command someone else. And a man cannot rule in the house of Yah unless his own house is in order. And that is not through some kind of oppressive nature. It's through the power and the evidence of his life and the strength of what is manifested in his bosom. Not because you brutalize your Isha and your children. And these weak boys today, mama's boys is what I call them. That's what they're mama's boys. They've been brought up on the mama's dress tail. And that's how she treats them too. And that's a fact. Glad I didn't let my mother treat me like a boy. When I got of age, I said, I know you're my mother, but I'm a man. And Yah's the head of Yahshua's the head of man. And I'm a man. And I'm your head. You're my Ima. You can't, well, that's not honoring them. No, if I allowed her to walk out of the command of Yah, then I would have dishonored her. I told her the truth. I'm the man. Well, I know you better than your wife. I said, I got a spot on my ass here. Do you know that? She does. So you don't know me like she does. Are you? We're so weak. We're fledgling little old boys. Where are the men of audacity and strength and character? And when they speak, they command attention. You don't even find that today. Well, I got a problem with you. Shut up. Did I set him down there in Hope, Michigan? Shut your mouth. Sit down, man. And they just looked. They were afraid. Revelation chapter 12, verse 3. Yokohan said, there appeared unto him this great wonder in Hashemaam. In the heavens. And behold, he said, a red, a red dragon, a tanim, having seven heads and seven horns and seven crowns. Now, I want to deal with that, but I want to, we must understand the nature of this beast. Well, it is not some Barney the puffy little dinosaur. He says, so a kingdom that rose up out of the bosom of Esau, because he was the one that was red. He was the one that was ruddy. He says, so I saw the nature of Esau. What is the nature of Esau? He is one that mocked Israel. He is the one that has disdain for Israel. And he said, I saw the combination of people of every color of skin rise up unto this combated nation of power of kingdoms. And this was the very nature and the seed of Esau. Let me read this. Hallelujah. This is the first assault upon the kingdom of Yah here in the book of Gilead, Revelation. I want to read this quickly. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 25. You all know where it's at, but I want to read it quickly. Revelation 25, 25. What is said in Gilead, if it has no Bereshit and the beginning of the Torah, it is of no value. And you just can't read it to understand. You must lahag, you must diligently meditate, search, and seek out the remedy of the answer. It says here in Revelation chapter 25 and verse 25, this is what it says. This Atmoni, it says Revelation 25, 25, and the first came out, he was Atmoni, all over like a hairy garment, and they called his name Esav. And the one that shall rise up against Israel, this is the first beast that shall rise up with great tenacity. He said, I saw this red, Revelation chapter 25 and verse 25. I'm sorry, Giliana. I'm sorry again, Bereshit. That's in Genesis 25, 25. That's all right. You shouldn't frown on that. You come on. Hallelujah. But it's in the beginning. Genesis chapter 25, verse 25. And the first that came out, he was red all over like a hairy garment. And they call his name Esav. Did he not see this red beast of this kingdom that rose up? This Tanim? Is not this nation of America? Is it not her symbol is one that is of a beast that devours and destroys? He saw this entity of hell to be raised up to combat against the house of Israel, to break it down, to destroy any of its wisdom, its knowledge, to break down any of the support lines as way of knowledge, understanding the wisdom of Torah, and to cause the seven Ruachim of Yah, to the light of that to go out. And so as Yakahar on this isle in the Aegean Sea, Isle of Patmos, this rocky place, we know that Yah is a rock, Israel. So he placed him there. And he began through the Ruach of Yah, he began to see the revelation of all things that shall be as Yesha, as Hanak, and all the messengers before him. He saw a kingdom. And the only way he could express that unto us, that it has come out of the loins of Esau. It has culminated as Esau still has this indignation against Israel. That's why in the book of Obadiah, I will preach that one day, Yah tells us, Israel, leave Esau alone. Don't mess with him. Don't mock him. Don't try to take from him. Don't try to overthrow him. He said, because the day is coming, I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill his damn babies, his wives. I'm going to kill the whole damn house. And damn it, when I kill them, I will dig them up and damn it, kill them again. He's going to kill them all. Muth. Muth. They're going to die prematurely. And so he saw this entity of hell. Look at this nation, 237 years old. It was raised up out of what? Was it not raised up out of bloodshed? Was it not raised up out of the dumb of people? Did not they call the people here the red men when they came? That is the truth, Yisra'iyah. It was raised up by death. It was raised up by stealing. It was raised up by destruction. That is what this nation was raised up by, Yisra'iyah. Yah is the one that raised up Yisra'iyah. He brought them out of a people that had no value at all. And he set his seal upon that nation and said, they are mine. They are the weakest of people. They have no land. They have nothing, but that's mine. And I shall give them a heritage that is called, they shall be my Hebrews. They shall be the sons of Abraham. And we know it means from beyond. And Yah is going to bring the resources of Yisrael from beyond our ability to comprehend and to think. So he sees this beast, this government, that its strength is based in the principles of Esav. Greedy, loves to hunt, loves to kill, and they're hunting for the true lineage of Yisrael. They're not hunting deer and bear. They're hunting the people. How? They're hunting to destroy every element of the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach. That's why all of this vile mess is being purported. That's why they're trying to press on you, it's all right for men to marry men. That's why they want to impress upon you that it's a civil marriage. What in the hell is a civil marriage? With a man and a man, a woman and a woman. And so that you began to destroy the immune system that is built up by Torah, that you began to accept that and to receive that. And then you began not to speak out against it because Yah loves everyone. You're a damn liar. He doesn't love everyone. He hated those damn Egyptians that came out to Yisrael. And those that came to say to destroy him, destroyed them into death. He did not extend his hands to the Hittites or the Jebusites. He did not give them a Torah. He gave Yisrael Torah, nation of people that were his. Yah said, I will destroy nation. I will give nations for the house of Yisrael. He's going to destroy this whore here, America. She is the purveyor of every kind of filth, every kind of religious dogma. She is a stinking, dirty whore. And no one wants to say that. America's sweet. She is not sweet. She's rotten to the core. She's full of death. She kills your baby. She burned their damn minds out with videos all day long. She got their minds wrapped up in a damn net of internet or interspeculation. She drives your wife and your husband, separate them, defy them, trying to make a living. Trying to sustain the American way. What is that? American way is death. He saw this nation of Esav, this mindset of destructiveness against Yah, the assault against Yah. You tell me this nation is not assaulting anything that is right? Sure it is. What it tells nations that are poor, we will not give you food unless you allow faggots to marry. And their ruler said, damn you, Mr. Obama. Or they want to say it's Red China over there. Oh, that's a part of this Issa mind. That's why America is united with China. That is a communist nation because they can make money. They can rob. They can rape their daughters. These freaks can go there and have all kind of sexual perverse activities. And a little nation 90 miles off the coast, they will not even allow them to get damn corn on credit. You tell me that's not a damn beast? A little nation whereby it's poverty. And they said that Mr. Fidel Castro was failing, yet the people are living, they're sustaining, they're happy, they work together, they live together. I don't give a damn if you don't like it. He cussed. Well, when you call your friend your guy and you curse, all right. I know you haven't heard one like this. That's all right. Hallelujah. I don't cringe on my words either. And yet the same nation that abused the people and this thing in what they call the damn White House talks about human rights, and yet they abuse, they imprison people. They destroy one childbirth policy. I was listening some weeks back, a woman that was 7 months pregnant. They made the woman have an abortion. She died. And so all those that were in charge of the communal construct, they were all fired. They made the woman have an abortion because it is exactly one child. Because they're getting this cheap stuff from China. And because the rich merchants, go ye rich man, weep and howl for the misery that shall come upon you. And these rich bastards, they are the manzir, they're bastards. They have not the life or the testimony of Yahshua. And they have these vile things in these whorehouses you call the church that are fat, greedy beasts and feed their flesh with greed. They're sumptuous. And they live like dogs, Yisrael. Hallelujah. That is the truth. That is the truth. But yet they will, and all these honorable senators and the president, they will wreak havoc on little Cuba, because Mr. What's his name in Venezuela? I know his name. Come on, help me. There. Come on, what's his name? The Prime Minister of Venezuela. What's his name? Ah. Someone help me. I know his name. Even when the price of oil was going up, he wanted to give poor people in New York and the cities, because oil in those countries costs 20 cents a gallon, 25. And what he says, you're not going to rob our people. We will subsidize. We will make it a national entity. Are you taking our oil out? You're selling it for $100 a barrel and you're giving us $5 a barrel? You're not going to do that. And all of a sudden, he is a terrorist. He's harboring terrorists. This nation is a terrorist nation. She has bombed the babies in their sleep in Afghanistan and Iran. These same ones that call themselves conservative Christians, liberal Christians, love everybody, but it's all right to bomb those babies. Yah says, I'm going to unleash the terror of hell upon your own damn babies. I'm going to cause those that are educated and refined, that come from the beautiful suburbanite neighborhood, I'm going to raise them up to kill your damn babies. They're going to go in there. They're going to shoot your sons, your daughters. They're going to kill them all. They're going to be all front to hell in the synagogues of death. So he raised up a fool like Mr. Holmes. Should he raise them up? Did he raise up Pharaoh?
Yes.
Did he raise up Pharaoh?
Yes.
He raised up that beast as well. And Yah says, I'm going to raise death in this cauldron of death. Why? Because what comes from this nation? Death, doesn't it? What nation kills like this nation? Well, you go in Zaire, they're fighting. They have some of the oldest antiquated weapons that have come from Russia, that have come from China, that has come from America. Come on. You think they're giving them those carbine weapons? They create division, this wicked system to create death. Again, I reiterate, 50% of the Americans own less than 1% of the total wealth. If that's not robbery, I don't know what it is. And you defend this damn mess. You defend America like she's Yah's nation. She is this nation. He's going to bring her down to hell like no other nation. No nation been like this. What's going to happen to you? I'm going to die in Yahshua HaMashiach. You're not going to pull your weapon out. I will pull it out. Conan can't do that. I will pull out the sword. My friend, you can't take my life. I'll lay it down. Yahshua said, you can't take my life. I'll lay it down. You have no power to do that. So your military might, your power, you don't need to come here that way. You're hope. Let's prepare a meal for these brutal killers. Why would I do that? Are they our enemies? Then Yah says, if your enemies are hungry, you feed them. So you feed the devils of hell and feed them. Is that all right? Get him some water. We don't have Kool-Aid, but we got some excellent water here from our wells. And they sure can cook a mean meal. That's what I will do, Yisra'el. That's it. You think that we can muster enough strength with a few little pop guns to take down any kind? I've been in the military. And when I was in there during that era, it's antiquated concerning what they got now. They can drop some nuclear heads here and everything here will fly. Contained within this little parameter. Are we that stupid? You'll raise up this whore to show you the excellence of his might and his power. Oh God, raise up America. You're right. The God of this damn whore, Hashatan. That's the God of America. Is America full of greed? We can't have enough, can we? Is it full of lust? Do they spread every kind of filth?
Yes.
They got your children's minds so messed up that they believe in a damn Batman?
Yes.
You mamas are so damn twisted, you buy them Batman drawers and Batman t-shirts. You know that's twisted. And yet there's no time of prayer in your house. There's no copy of the Torah. There is no writing of the mitzvah. But yet they got a Batman on the wall. It is the truth. I don't apologize to this wicked generation. I'm going down in the fight. I'm going down. I'm here to go down. I'm going down for ya. I know this is not his kingdom. Because Joshua said, if this was my kingdom was of this world, he said, I will fight for it. My Abba will send the Melechim and we will fight for it. This is not his kingdom. America's not his kingdom. These religious harlots have messed our minds up. We don't even know who is of Yah, and we don't even know who is of the devil. We can't even discern. He saw this mighty kingdom. I want to work on that a little bit. He saw this appearing of this beast, this Tanim, in the heavens, and he was red. It is the very nature of Esav. He saw this Admoni was not the first to come. Was he not red? You have no revelation of what Revelation is trying to express of Giliana unless we go back to the Bereshits. And we must go back to Genesis. Was not Esav one that is called Admoni, the red, the ruddy, the red one? Was he not the first one to assault or come against the assault of Yisrael Yaakov? Until that one that was a supplanter, his name was changed. He pursued him. And he was afraid. And he ran. Until Yah says, I change your name from Yaakov, from the supplanter. You shall be known as Yisrael, that Yah is the one that has caused you to prevail. And he were pursuing him then. That's why he sent waves of gifts unto Yisrael, unto Esav. Because he was pursuing him. And so it is in this nation here and the world as a whole. This nation pursues every nation. It pursues the radical transformation. Look at what has happened through their media process. They go over there, Britain, this wicked whore, and they bring down Mr. Mubarak. They go down and they destroy Mr. They're in Libya. Muammar Gaddafi, and now the whole damn nation, both of them in chaos, killings, everybody. You don't hear that in the media, do you? The governments are messed up. They went there to Afghanistan, they raised up Mr. Omar, they gave them weapons to fight against Russia. And these bastards tell you to buy silver for them to get rich. They want your fiat currency. They raised up Mr. Omar. They call him the one-eyed Muslim. He was a warrior too. I remember hearing that boy say, he said this. I remember him saying this. I heard the man. I saw a clip. He said this. Out of his mouth, he says, the Russians proved to be tough. They were tough boys. He said, but they weren't that tough. After 7 years, the Russians had to flee, give it up. He said they were tough boys. I've seen clips where those boys, that Musa, Hajim, would hide in the mountains and fire would rain on these beasts and they would run and they would kill them. They would kill babies with them. They would kill them because they were going to kill their babies. They were going to kill their babies. And he says it's going to be a challenge for the American boys because they like video games and things. I don't think they can handle us. They raised up Mr. Omar. They did Yisrael. They raised this man up to try their weaponry, the small arms, against Russia. And now the Taliban with Mr. Kaiser, they're negotiating where, because those people, they don't give up. They got a cause that they fight. That's what a warrior does. He never gives up. The cause of a warrior is greater. He doesn't worry about shoes. I read John that was in Afghanistan. He said, Rayak, it's insane. He said, you see these cats, it's freezing in the mountains. They got on sandals, no socks. They got their cloak on, and they got their weapon. They sleep on a mound of dirt, they have their covering, and they're ready to fight. He says, it's weary, it's vexing. You never see nothing like that. See, the boys from America used to
twiddling their thumbs and eating jelly rolls and jelly pops. And they get some bread and their tea every day and they're happy. They're not overweight and fat like us, all right? Thin men. Hallelujah. Oh, don't worry about it. You all just bear with me, all right? Just bear with me. I'll bring it to a compliment. I'll bring in all that, all right? I know what I'm doing. You all trust me, all right? And so as this nation has raised up her tentacles of death against every nation, we must understand, be not deceived, ye are not marked. For whatsoever nation or a man, the word nation, it is implied in instance as am, like in our vernacular am. Not only does it mean, it only imply that the goim or the goi or the goim or the goor, the nation, it means nation, the word am, means not only the physical nation, but the people too. You hear the word go or goim, goim is the multiple of go. It means nation. When you see the word nation, it is go. When you see the word in many cases in the Hebraic, the Aramaic, or the Ethiopic, it's talking about am. Am. It's talking about not only the physical nation, but the people of the nation as well. And many cases when Yah deals with Yisrael, he's talking about not only Yisrael, the people, but the physical nation that he's going to restore unto his people. He see this beast, this vile thing, with kingdom power that has the legion with the most prominent powers of the earth. We hear about the G7, don't we? We hear about China and America and Canada and Britain and France and all these northern nations is considered, because these are what they call the superpowers, or these are the subpowers unto the superpower. You understand? She has no economy, but she's super. She has no power, but she's super. She borrows $1 billion every day. And yet she borrowed from countries like Indonesia. She bombed those nations. She borrowed from countries like Pakistan that are poor and the people suffering, pressured them into buying their bonds and all of that. And you tell me we live in a blessed nation? We lived in a damn corrupt, wicked nation. She's vile and she's insidious. She's wicked and she doesn't give a damn about you. I don't care who you are. Give a damn what color your skin are. You think this nation cares about poor white folks or poor black people? And hell, they got poor white people crazy as hell and poor white black people thinking that all the blacks are getting something. They're not getting the damn thing. I'm not afraid to say that. We got to deal with reality. We're afraid to deal with the true issues. And so they have a great ability to divide people. It's all about, isn't that what the New World Order is about? Conquer, create chaos, conquer and divide. Isn't that what it's about? I know all these boys that study up on Illuminatis, they know that. The one that are the Illuminatis and they can tell you everything about the secret organization. Never been to a meeting now. But they believe everything they read, but yet they don't believe this book that they read it. They believe everything. Well, the Illuminati, damn the Illuminati, damn the Cumberfront, damn the Masons. Shut them off from you, you damn them. Ain't nothing a Mason can do, nothing that the Club of Rome. You think they got to be awful cowardly if they're that secretly, aren't they? Huh? They're full of lots, mysteries, and secretive conversation. They have no security in their wisdom. Maba has security in his wisdom. Hallelujah. He's not afraid to speak it. Well, this is somewhat of a social teaching. I know everything about a community is social. And everything about the community of Yisrael, it is social. It is a social gathering of his people. They have the common unity of one purpose, and that is to fulfill all things that Yah command through the power of the Torah. And they have the light of the revelation of Yahshua HaMashiach. So it is a social entity. We interact, we eat, and we lay, and we care for each other, just like you see the ants. Dude, are they not social? They take care of business, don't they? Sure they do. And so that's what the community of Yisrael is all about. That's what it's about. This kingdom is being raised up for one purpose, and that is to make the frontal assault against Yisrael. It is the very seed of Esav. It is the Atmoni. It is those that have the red or the marking of this nature that is against Yah, one that despises what is truth. How can America say she loves someone? And yet the little folks in Cuba starve and they suffer. And yet they will allow anything to go to China and buy all of their goods because they rape the poor people of China. They rape the poor people of China. You're not saving, but they're making money. And they don't give a damn about you. And that's a fact. Mr. Rush Limbaugh and these Sean Hannitys not even touch your hand unless you're part of their social circle. Mr. Limbaugh doesn't even shake the hands of the people, even those that were in his audience, because he was afraid that he may catch some kind of disease or some kind of a virus or something. Same thing with these fat dog preachers. The T.D. Jakes, the Benny Hinn, they don't touch those people. Benny Hinn just go, whoo, and they go, blah! It is right, my friend. Yes, sir. Benny Hinn just go, take it, boom, and whoo! And after the baskets of money are passed, he said, see y'all, dummies. And that's a fact. You don't have to buy it, but it's still the truth. Hallelujah. They don't even touch the people. They don't even touch them. They don't touch them at all. Again, he says, I know I'm going to drive this a little bit today. Get some of that mess out of us. Got all that trash in your heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He says in Revelation again, he says, and there appeared another wonder, Revelation 12:3, in the heavens. He said, behold, this was a red dragon. Now, if y'all put that descriptive, that atsmoni, there, then it has some relevance, doesn't it? So in order for us to understand the very nature of that, we must begin at the beginning of all things. So we began at Bereshit to give us some identity of the word atsmoni. A nation, a people. You tell me he saw what's Puff the Magic Dragon lives by the sea. That was in my days. All right. You in your 50s, you remember that one. All right. So you tell me he was talking about Puff the Red Dragon, what they call a dragon. You tell me he was talking about some kind of bohema, a big beast, something that is large, and that's what he's talking about. We were looking at some pictures yesterday of the North Carolina Zoo, and she says to me, Papi, I want to ride that giraffe. I said, that's one of the largest land mammoths in the world. He's tall. I don't know how you're going to ride him. I think it's best to look at him because he's a powerful, vicious thing. It will knock you out. So you think it's some kind of little old Puff the Magic Dragon? You think this is what he saw? He saw the manifestation of a kingdom. That he identified that kingdom as the very savvy and in the death throes of an Esav. He called that atmoni, and he called it a tanim, a beast, a beastly power that doesn't give a damn. America doesn't give a damn. She kills, she burns, she destroys. She kills nations, she kills people, she kills land, she destroys land. The land in this country is destroyed. You can't even grow anything in the fields, Yisraya. In our days in the 60s and 70s, at least you ride down the street, you see all kind of bugs. You can go 5 miles before the bugs are all on your windshield. Is that right? You couldn't travel through the country. I can drive from here all the way to Atlanta and not get one bug on my windshield. I drive through the country roads. Why? Because of the death of the chemicals and everything they're using to kill us off. Kill off our brain cells that we can't even think. We can't even live without a damn internet or television. You don't even sit in life, Yisrael. You ride around here. I can drive to Monroe through all that rural country setting and not get one, not even a small tick of a bug. In the days, every 10 miles, you have to stop at the gas station somewhere, wash your windshields, and keep rolling. You don't even see life like that. This is a nation of death. They kill your babies in the womb. They suck them up. They destroy them. And they try to thrust that on everyone. And in order for them to bring about a resolution that there will be no life procreation, they say a man can marry a man. That beast, that's not even a beast. Forgive me, y'all. I will not even mock your creation to that degree to call that big bull out there to equate that with a dog of a man.
That has nothing to do with righteousness. You don't even know what the Sadiq of the Sadiq Hanaviyah is. Hallelujah. At the time we move away from the Torah of Yah, we began to go about establishing our own right ways. Then it produced a neda, a cloth, a rag that is filthy. It is of the essence of a minister rag from a woman that is so vile and sad. What purpose can you use it for? What purpose can you use it for? I say this for us as Yisrael to come out of her, my people. Come out of the mindset of America. Come out. You don't try to buy weapons to bear arms against this country. I'm not bearing no arms against it. That's stupid. I want to live my life. We must pray for even the leaders. If it's Mr. Romney or Mr. Barack Hussein Obama, it makes me no difference. If it's Mr. Bushman, I don't care who they put in there. I don't care who they put. It makes me no difference. So you pray for them, what? Not that you say, oh yeah, bless Mr. Obama with peace, with Syria, and make everything right. You pray that you as a nation of Israel, that in this wicked nation, in your prayer, you can live a life that is quiet and full of shalom. Your life is quiet. You're not interfering or interacting in their affairs and their activity, because your kingdom power, the rule of your government, has nothing to do with this government. Your legion is unto Yah, for his nation, Yisra'yah. That's where your legion is. We're soldiers in that army. That's who we're going to fight for. What if they come to your shores? You have gone to their shores and butchered their babies. You drop bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. You drop those bombs 4, 5, 6 miles, everything. Can you imagine a beautiful woman like you that your baby just burned to a crisp in your arm, and for some reason the vortex of that escaped you. It was like a vortex and you were not consumed with that, and yet you look at your babies and it's fried. Here you standing here and you see the meat consumed off of someone's bone. What kind of mind thinks like that? Is that not the Hamad, the Kamat of Yah? That's total destruction. There is nothing there. That's wiped out. That's the mind of Hoshatan. When a mind goes beyond the law of Yah, the law of Yah's order, that's the mind of a beast. That's not even a beast. That's not even the nature of a human being, Yisra'yah. Even the beasts of the field will care. Even the cow will let a yearling suck her teeth, whether it's hers or someone else's. Even a true ima that has a lot of milk, she would say, give me that baby and put the baby on her titty and let the baby suck the titty milk. What kind of mind is that? And you tell me we as a nation, we should not assault that and confront it and challenge that. We don't do it because we're weak. We got this little rosy thing. Oh, Yah loves everybody. No, he doesn't. He still hates Esau. And he's going to destroy Esau. So he's going to allow this grandeur of promenading himself as this mighty kingdom to show that I can dispel your kingdom. You notice this battle is against Yah. It is based upon one thing, and that is worship, Yisra'yah. These liars telling folks to buy gold, these are bastards. These are the mamzeers. These are dirty dogs. They tell you your fiat currency is not worth a damn, but they want your silver. You want that silver? Give me some fiat. No, give me a C note. Give me $100 bill. Oh, I know. No, let's trade off some silver. No, I don't want that, because I can't take this to the mortgage and pay my $8,000 a month house payment. And they're telling you to buy silver. They're telling you to supply enough food for 6 months. You jackasses, you stupid people. You tell me that a nuclear assault, even if it's upon us, that you got that little stuff in them little tubs and all that is going to land. When are you going to plant the seeds when the ground is saturated? When they went there in Vietnam, when they dropped that Agent Orange, it was to destroy, to defile everything. Nothing lived. Even the bodies of the soldiers died. Two brothers that they are messed up from Nam. One died, the other one is near dead. I don't give a damn if you feel uncomfortable with me. I intend for you to feel uncomfortable. Shows you what's in you. I got two brothers that's dying. Cancer. What they did to those young men. 56,000 men.
And they bombed the hell out of a nation because they said 3,000 people were killed. You killed 56,000 men in Vietnam. You killed 56,000. It was devastating in our little poor communities. Russell Minton is dead. Ma! It was devastating because everybody knew everybody. You killed 56,000 boys for what? To make Mr. Johnson and the Kennedys and these bastards rich. To make them rich. And yet they serve in capacities, their sons and their grandchildren and their families, not in harm's way. Clerks. Yeah. Pushing the pens. And these fat hogs like Mr. Limbaugh, America Chisholm, and he sets on his fat arse and tell your boys to go, and it's an honorable thing. They come back broken limbs and they're on the street. That boy John come back, his mind is messed up. He said, Rayok, I saw death every day. I said, don't lie to me, boy. He said, Rayok, I saw death every day. I said, boy, get out of my face. I knew he wasn't lying to me. That's the only reason I continued to reach out to that kid. It messed him up. He said, Rayok, it messed me up. And they don't give a damn about that boy. He's messed up. He said, I saw him dead. I said, boy, you see? He said, Rayok, bodies burned, mutilated. He said, you walk by nothing but bags. You know what's there. He said, you know what's there, Rayok. You know what's there. They're dead bodies. The stench of death. He said, I couldn't handle it. And he broke. I had this little young educated officer. He said, Rayok, we were in one of the most hellish battles, intense fighting. He said, you got all of this heavy gear on. It's 120 degrees. It's hot. And the bullets, he said, when they began to fly, baby, they flew all day. He said, it was an intense assault. They just fly. He said, fears and everything just permeate your mind. You don't know what to do. You're afraid. You're fearful. And he said, after about 2 or 3 hours, the assault kind of dissipated. He said, I was so wore out. He said, I was sitting there. He said, it was taxing. Can you imagine that, trying to shoot one of those carbines? I know M16s when I was in the... It was nothing like the weapons they had today. He said, I was so exhausted, so torn. He said, and this little young officer walks up to me and tell me, get up off your ass. He said, man, give me a minute. I'm warm. He said, get up. He said, before I knew it, I was up in him. He had snapped. I have sympathy for people like that. I feel sorry for them, you understand? Now, I don't tell y'all everything I do because we're a pack of damn hypocrites. And he knows that there's nobody out there that would show him any consideration but this man. He's called me twice. I haven't returned his call. I'll call him. And to destroy your children's minds like that, for what? For who? He won't prosper one bit. I got a brother, Len, up from the Agent Orange, dying. Cancerous legs. My oldest brother, 67 years old. He's dying. He's dying. For what? For a better country? For freedom of speech, freedom of rights? That was a thing that messed him up more than anything. He came back to this country. And they assailed him. And the same damn racism that when he left. I recall I'm a 60 baby, okay? I grew up, I was a teenager in the 60s, okay? He said, this is what I fought for. And he became very disillusioned. He was never able to recoup from that. That's the truth. He was a hellacious soldier. 27 missions over the Nile. He was a helicopter door gunman. Powerful cat. Shoots at M60 with one hand. He's a hellacious man if he did that. I said, you couldn't do that, boy. Come on, man. I'm bigger than you, stronger. He said, baby boy, I could clip it all with one hand. Bam! You will have to see the gun to understand what he was saying. You will have to shoot one like I've shot one to understand the veracity of a weapon like that and the recoil. and you root him with one hand, and you shoot him with one hand, and after about 1,500 rounds, the barrel is red as fire. You got to snatch that off and put another one. You got to, come on now. You tell me that's not terror? It's terrorizing. You got to watch bodies falling. You know it's falling. You're never intended to be that way. If we keep the mitzvah of Yah, if we walk in the Torah of Yah, then we will do it right by each other. When our enemies want to assault us, bring gifts. Here's some food. Isn't that what Yisrael did? That's what Yaakov did? Send him some gifts. You're not going to be able to buy. You're not going to be able to sell yourself to the service of Yah. He's not going to buy your testimony. He's not buying anything, Yisrael. That's the reason I'm going this way. You all bear with me. Hallelujah. Again, Revelation 12:3, and there appeared another wonder in the Shemaim, the great red dragon. He had 7 heads, and he had 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his head. He had 7 diadems. Did they have a correlation or representative of one of the most powerful things upon the earth? I want to read that, though. And I will get to the other attributes as well. But he had 7 crowns or 7 diadems upon his crown. A perfect order, a perfect law, a perfect rule. You must understand that what they call the cardinal number of 7, it is the one of completion and perfection. And so in order for this to have for this kingdom to have a complete perfect order, it must be ordained by Yah. It must be ordained by Yah. Everything that happens is not by some chance. It's not the hands of HaShatan. It is Almighty Yah. He is the one that is the orchestrator of all things. He is the one that constructs all things. He is the one that permits and allows all things, Yisrael, especially among Yisrael. He has given the wicked over unto the mindset of darkness. So there's a kingdom that the seven crowns or the 7 dynamics of this kingdom, this is the power that shall rule in the kingdoms that it shall have authority over. You understand? Or the 7 dynamics of Edom or the Edomites or Esav, it is of his perfection. Listen, it is his perfect perfection in what is mandated and commanded for him to carry it out, and he will carry it out with preciseness. He will not miss his mark, Israel. When those bombs drop, they don't miss their marks. I was talking to Simeon. I said, you know, one warhead of a nuclear bomb has more destructive power. It has the destructive power of 10 million. 10 million, the force, as the atomic bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. It literally sets the heavens on fire. The heavens burn. It is a liquid fire. That's why in Chernobyl, when they're not telling us all that's coming out of Japan. What is that? Fukushima, Japan. And Simeon and I were talking about this morning. He said, maybe there's some of the effects of it coming from Japan. I said, well, you know, could be. But when in Chernobyl, they buried that plant. They buried everything 10 miles deep in the ground on the concrete. And the radioactivities, no life there at all. Everything is death. Everything is raya. But the fire of Yah is greater than that. That's why Jeremiah says, like fire in my bones, shut up. His word is a fire. And he's going to destroy them with the fire of his tongue. And they're raising up, Esau is raising up an army. Listen, they will not have the ability to see, and they don't see Yahshua. So the only thing they can fight against, as we have seen with Pharaoh, as we have seen during the time of Yahshua HaMashiach, is to take out the birth of the testimony of Yahshua from the heart of Yisrael. And so you got this cross mutilation of every kind of hybrid damn doctrine today. Men living wickedly and sinful, drawing out what is of their advantage and giving themselves some kind of supreme identity who they are. And they don't have a damn thing. You understand, Yisrael?
They think that they're intellectual, spiritual, intellectual. They actually think that they have some kind of scholarship. They have read some books by some other man. They have not labored in the Torah, you understand. They have read some books. They have gotten some booklets. They write everyone for booklets. They read what they get, and they bring that into an amalgamation of a hodgepodge of damn mess. And they try to share that with everyone. It's not that they have any scholarship of knowledge of the matter. It's not that they have experienced anything. These young boys haven't experienced nothing but a skateboard, and a video game. That's it. And that's a fact. Here they don't even have time for y'all. They got time to skate, though. Woo! Woo! You haven't experienced nothing. You can tell a man of his mastery skills in his activities. Hallelujah. You can tell a strong man, you're walking with him, he's strong, man. Ooh, wow, you can tell he's doing something. I showed this old man, he was 60 years old. I said, look at this old man. 60 years old, be 61. He said, I do 500 push-ups every morning. I go to the park and do another 250. Then I do 10 sets of, no weights or nothing like that. I said, well, man, when I get 60, I sure would like to look like that. You're big and strong. No fat gut, it's just lean and so you tell that he was a student of his activity. Not only a student, but he was a steward. He said every morning, 750 push-ups every day. I do it every day, 5 days a week. Oh, look at us. Come on. We want our bowl of Cheerios and hog chitlins. That's what we want. We want our shrimp and lobster. That's what we want. We don't want no endeavor that challenged this wickedness about us. We don't want that. We're going to let our mind suffer nothing. But the day is coming. You're not going to be able to buy your chitlins or your pig feet. And you forget your shrimps and all of that. It's in the book too. Can I read this a little bit? Hallelujah. I'm working something. Just bear with me. Todaya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He says he having seven crowns upon his head. I want to read something. Turn quickly to Yeshaya, Isaiah. There must be a force to combat Yah Yisrael. Yeshaya chapter 11. It says that he has seven diadems upon his head. What is this? Isn't this kingdom power and assault against Yah and his kingdom? Isn't there is a battle between kingdoms that what we would identify as spiritual? In essence, they are invisible to the natural eye because the mysteries of that has been kept sealed until the time that it should be revealed. So we can read things. That doesn't mean we understand things. You can show people, whoever done this, just hear me. Have you ever purchased anything, got the instructions, read the instructions, and could not put it together? Have you ever purchased anything, got the instructions, tried to put it together, and could? See, I'm not excellent at that at all because I don't read the instructions. I tend to look at the box, and then I have missing pieces of parts that are not missing parts that were not included in the process. And that's the way we are, Yisrael. Hallelujah. And it's just the truth whether you buy it or not. So what are these seven crowns? What is this? A crown shows the authority of a kingship or the authority of one's power and might. Hashatan always and has always battled Yah on the perimeter. Everything. What he says to Yah, what you do, I can do. What you raise up, I can do. Did not Yah raise up one out of his bosom? Did not one come out of the heart of Yah? His name is Yahshua. He is the living Torah of Yah. Did he not raise him up? What do you think is going to come out of Esav? What are you going to think come out of him? A kingdom that will fight against the kingdom of Yah. It is a mindset. It is an order. It is a religious order. It is a physical identity that is associated with a spiritual identity, Yisrael. And so he must establish this perfect order to his kingdom that it can compete against that which is perfect. Is not the Torah of Yah perfect? Was not Yahshua the word of Yah made flesh? Was he not Tamin? Was he not complete in the order of the Torah? So there must be a kingdom that is complete and its despondence of the Torah to battle against it without any kind of emotions or feeling. Cannot have no love for it. So that's what the enemy tries to do. So Yah says, I raise up one. Listen to this quickly here in Yeshaya, Isaiah 11, chapter 11, verse 1. He said, and there shall come forth a rod, a ruler. That's what the word, the Shebat, the Shebat. It is the rule, it is the tribe, it is the authority. He said, there shall come a Shebat. A Shebat is a branch. And that's what Yahshua, he said, there shall come a rod, a branch, out of the stem of Yesse. Yesse. There shall come one out of the loins, out of the lineage of Yesse. Is this kingdom of hell, has it come out of the lineage of Esav? You know that is so because its nature, this Tanim, this dragon, it is red. It is Atzmoni. It is Atzmoni. It is ruddy. It is red. It comes from the earth. You understand, Yisrael? So the kingdom that shall come against the spiritual kingdom of Yah, it has been raised up out of the earth. And Esau was an earthly man. He loved to hunt. He loved to kill. He loved the savory venison. You understand? As it was in the days of Noah, they were eating and drinking. That is the mindset of Esau. And they knew not the coming. They knew not the destruction of Yah until it came upon them. So it shall be in the coming of Yahshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. I like you, man. You, my friend. I like me. Forgive me. I love me. You don't love you? That's why you don't give a damn about no one else. Yah commands us to love our neighbors as we love. And I love me a lot. I love me a whole lot. I love me. I love me a lot. I said, I love you, boy. You stupid beast. But I love you. That's how talk to me. You jackass. You're an ignorant, wicked man. But I love me a lot. I really love me. I love me. I do. I love me a lot. And if you don't love you, you're sick. I love me. I like to look at me in the morning, too. Yeah. I like to look at me. I like you, boy. Walk past the mirror, look. I would tell you one day what she says to me. This woman that Yah gave to me, all right? I tell you one day. So I love me. So if I don't love me, how can I love her? And if I can't love me, how can I love him? If I can't love me, how can I love him? If I can't love me, how can I love you? And so my love is to the point whereby I will never dishonor her. To try to draw into some kind of sedition or to be around playing around with her, talking this chit chat, talking. We just having fun. Hey, girl, what's up, girly girl? You sure look nice. How you doing? Being silly, you understand? So I love her enough not, and I love him because I love me, so because I love him, I would never try to pollute his house. I would run because my love for me honors me and my love for him honors him as I honor me. You understand? And yet these bastards say they love people. Oh, I love everyone! You liar. I've never said that because I didn't know how to love everyone. I would say to them, if you love everyone, there's the bomb that's bleeding from his gum that you have disdained. Bring him into your house if you love. Well, no, I can't do that now. That's love? You damn hypocrite. So there must be a perfect order established out of the bosom of Esav that he has calculated his power and it shall be represented in the dimension of kingdom powers. All the great kingdoms mesh into this mayhem of this great kingdom ruler. The Medo-Persians, the Babylonians, the Greek, and all the Roman entity of power. Whereby the sun never went down on the Roman kingdom. But Yah said, you got all that. Your horses and your chariot. I got one thing. I have the sword.
I have the fire of my mouth. You can drop your bombs, baby, but it's going to burn your children. America is going to pay. She has burned babies in every country. Hugo Chavez down in Venezuela. That's his name, Mr. Chavez. And because Mr. Chavez did not capitulate with this nation, then they call him a terrorist. He's hoarding terrorists and stuff like that. That's wrong. And America's a terrorist. America's a terrorist. And she's going to get what she has poured out is coming back. That's what Mr. Holmes, he poured it out on their babies. I don't mock that, but we're going to get what we do. We do unto others is coming back to us. That's why you got to lose all allegiance with this country as a nation. And your allegiance is unto the kingdom of Yah. You're a son of Yisrael. You fight for the kingdom. And you don't pick up no weapon of the flesh. The power of our weapon, they're not carnal, but they're mighty and powerful. To the Ruach of Yah, to the pulling down of strongholds. And we pull down the strongholds of hell. We're not picking up weapons to go to fight against the Russians or the Chinese. We're not going to go down there and destroy a little land like Mr. Reagan. Go down there to a Granada, a little piece of a tin can. I could have took some Crip boys. I could have taken my boys. And we could have went down there and thrashed them well. And this most powerful nation goes down there and rob and stomp a little people like that. You're not even a bully. You wonder why youngers are being bullied, because we bully everybody. We bully them into thinking like us and acting like us and doing wickedly like us. It's wrong. He goes down there to Mr. Granada, this Mr. Ronald Reagan riding in this saddle. What a wickedness. What a dirty bastard. That's what he was. So they raise up this damn beast we have now, Mr. Obama. He dropped bombs in Somalia, killing the pirates. And hell, the French, Belgium, Japan, they have robbed the coast. Every country has an international type of parameter 200 miles from the seashore. I guarantee you the boat from Somalia could not come here to South Carolina and come and fish within 200 miles of the seashore. You cannot enter into all the waters outside of international. You can fish. Well, life around the coastal region, that's all those people knew. They fish, and they had simple diets. And these beasts in their carriers that they would fish tens of millions of pounds of fish, they would dump this toxicity of waste and death in their land, killing off the reefs, killing off life, where men could go out. And now we got enough for the village to eat. Mom, he got enough. His little boats that he has carved out, they're not like the mighty vessels of the French or the British. And now he's got to go out 50 miles and his wife never sees him again. Because that's the only place he can catch fish to eat. And they don't even know what happened to him because he dies. And so they have what they call the warlords. They say, hell no. We're going to take their boats and capture them and take their damn money. Give us $25 million. Give us $10 million. Everyone that was captured by those, what they call pirates. It is amazing because we don't vilify pirates in this nation. We raise them up. Captain Hook. Oh, they are icons. We raise up. Come on, what's his name? Bonnie and Clyde. Come on, killing and stealing. I mean, they are monumental in the articles of this history of this nation. Movies made about them. They're glamorized. Well, Bill Hickok, Daniel Boone, all of them. So the little poor people had someone that was wise enough to say, man, no, we're going to take their stuff. They took ours. We're taking it back. I said, damn it, take it all. And they started capturing the ships. And the people were so kind, they would cook for the people. Those that were pirates, they were cooking pirates. And really, they make them all jump overboard and kill them all. They would cook for them. They knew they were going to get the money. Because they had, if they asked for $10 million, They had enough cargo. They probably had $100 million worth of cargo or $20 million worth of cargo on the ship. They were not about. And all the ships are insured. Everything is insured so that we get enough money. We can feed our babies. We can create commerce. And so the nations like Britain and Portugal and France, they were taking the toxicity in their waste. You understand those nations are not big. They're smaller places. Finland, Sweden, and Norway, little clover nations right there. But ain't nothing there. There's not even enough land to grow enough food for the people. So that's why most of what we call the nation, the continent of Africa, was colonized, to steal, to rob from the people, to kill, to butcher. And that's just the truth. We don't have to look at it, but it's just the truth. We can be that shallow and not face the reality of truth, because when we face the reality of truth, it shows us what's in us. And shows us what limits we have and shows what we need to get right. Wrong is wrong. I don't give a damn who it's by. It's wrong. Yeah, I'm preaching. This preaching, this dealing with the trash, it makes you upset. I'm still preaching. Let me read this quickly. I'm going to close here. Not because you want me to close. I'm going to close because I'm tired. That's right, Yosef. It says here, as I said, that he saw these crowns of great power, great dimension. Yeshaya, Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1. He said, and there shall come forth out of the rod, out of the shebat, and this is Yoshua, out of the stem of Yeshe. He said, it shall be a branch, shall grow out of his roots, and that shall be the strength. And listen now, out of Esau there is a branch that have grown out. It is a branch of assault against Yah. It is a mindset to captivate the host of the people to come against Yah. That's why you have the proliferation of Christianity and Judaism. I heard one say, now I say what I said about what happened there in Aurora, Colorado. Mr. Omar, the senator down there in Texas, he said the reason that happened was because there is an assault on Judaic Christian beliefs. What in the hell is Judaism Christian beliefs? And those that are of Judaism, they don't give a damn about those that call themselves Christians. They use this little flirtatious whore here called America for their own wealth and their own excellence and their own mobility. And they use these clowns like the Hagans and all these. We got to fight for Israel. We got to save that land to manipulate and to use them. But when it comes to the principles, they call them Goyim. They're damn fools and heathens. And they frankly don't give a damn about them. All they care about is the wealth and the money to substantiate the wealth there. And they don't give a damn about them. Mr. McCain can go there, but to them, he is a Goyim. He is a girl. He is a heathen. He is a damn beast. And Mr. Obama can go there, but he is still a damn beast. He sits down with Mr. Netanyahu. He looks at him as a damn despicable thing. He's unclean. You don't want to touch him. And if he went there in the Hasidic neighborhood of New York, they would say, damn you, man, you don't touch us. And that's a fact. I don't give a damn if you're a white man, a brown man, a Jew. They don't touch you. It's a fact. We are so damn silly. We are silly people. This is a stupid nation. We're forever learning, but we never come to knowledge of truth. This nation is stupid, and they think they're intellectual. It's not stupid. When a young man that was in college for his PhD, neuroscience, and he goes out and kills 12 people and shoots 70, that's a crazy boy. And the neighborhood says, well, he was a loner like, but he come from excellent stock. He did. My mother may have been a Jezebel, but she will put the rod on that buttock. She will straighten you out, boy. You wouldn't bother going about killing nobody. And Isaac, ain't I dysfunctional? She didn't dysfunction me. She made me functional. She made me function what was right in the proper protocol. I am functional. How about that? There was a superlative they used. It was like the, what was that? It was in the Charlotte Observer this morning. He come from a spoilish upbringing that his parents spoiled him. I tell you what, I knew I wasn't spoiled. Wasn't nothing about that. And so this man was an exceptional student, and this intellectual. And people would say, he was a smart criminal, very bright. I don't know how you would be a bright criminal when you get caught. That to me, is that a bright criminal? Don't call me bright. I don't want to be bright. I don't want to be smart. I don't want to be smart. I don't want to be bright. Hallelujah. He's a bright criminal, and he's a criminal.
Well, this man, he has the highest, what is that? IQ in America. He tests at 187.
And he's a damn bartender? He thinks he's intellectual? Let's get real.
Well, Harvard is a prestigious university, Yale, Princeton, and so what we do, it's based upon the IQ and the CAT and the tests that they take.
Hell, then when the Chinese come over here and crush everybody, and the Indians, the school take 5,000-6,000 people, then the place should be full of Chinese people, full of those from Africa. Sure should be, because they max out. They bust the ACT and all of that, SAT. They bust it. And they have altered the IQ test because it's such a stupid thing. The questions are so damn stupid, have no relevance in life. And that's what is classified as intellectual. I don't want to be intellectual. Let me be dumb. I want to be dumb. I want to read this in closer. Is that all right today? Because I got work tomorrow. I got much to do. It says, verse 2, and the Spirit of Yah shall rest upon him. He gives us the power of those spirits. The Ruach HaKodesh, that is the Ruach of Yah. He said the spirit of wisdom, of chuchmah. He said that the spirit of bina, of bin, understanding. He talks about the ruach musa, of counsel, in depth, the spirit of correction. You see, in this kingdom, there shall be seven powerful entities. And we're going to touch on that. Don't worry, I got it. I will show you them. Hallelujah. And the forces of the kingdom power of darkness to battle against the Ruach of Yah. He says the Ruach of counsel. He says the Ruach of the spirit of Ruach of might, power, and strength. He said, and the Ruach of Da'at, of knowledge, seven Ruachim. He said, and the fear of Yah. There are seven right there. These are the crowning diadems of the crown of Yahshua. Well, what is that Yahshua? What crown? That's the crown of his mind. And we shall let the same mind that was in Yahshua HaMashiach, that mind must be in us. And if we have the mind of Yahshua, these are the diadems, the crowns of that mind. It's seven. And these are seven powerful entities of spiritual identities that shall exalt a nation, nations and kingdoms to rise up against Yah. Your rhetoric will be to destroy every relic, every identity of Yah, to come and in to rob your heart. And that's why things like fictitious things are so rampant. They're selling, and people love that. They don't want things that are nonfiction. They love silly, crazy reading. They don't want things that are true to the core. They're selling the video games, the gory killing, and the foolishness of death. The death, they're insensitive to that. These boys, before they sent them to Iraq and Afghanistan, that's all they played, the gory video games of killing. That's why they were raised up to take sensitivity of death away from them. Something is wrong when you have no sensitivity to death. I went down, as I said, down here in our community. Steve, he died. And so I went the other day. I was filthy, I was dirty, and I left when I was leaving the job, and I stopped hauling. And then I walked in the store, and the lady, she knew me. And so I wanted to speak to his wife. And I could say that with all legitimacy and honesty, he was very kind to me. I've never seen him unkind to any man. But that doesn't garner you the kingdom. And I wanted to convey that, my condolences and sadness about his death, because I'm telling you, it was tough for me. I like Steve, I really did. Although he called himself a Greek and we would get in some of our battles, and I would not back down. You understand? I would not back down one scintilla. If he killed me, that's all right. I take your stance. And that's the only stance I take. I don't take the stand of no ethnicity. I take the stand of Yah. And if you do that, you're wicked. You take the stand of a white man, it's corrupt. Black man, a Jew man, we take the stance of Yah. And I stand in that truth. Damn all white men, black men, Jew men, they're corrupt. Hallelujah. And I don't take it back. How about that? And I'm not afraid to say it. Well, I won't give you a nickel. That's all right. I'll be all right. Again, before I close, let me reiterate here. And I'm going to pick up from here again, Yesoraya. It says that in Revelation 12:3, he saw this great wonder in the heavens, it was a miracle. And he called him a great. He uses the word gadol. He used that superlative, a great red tanim, a venomous monster of death. That is what a tanim is. He saw this great monster. He had 7 heads and 10 horns. I'll show you what that is too. There were 10 tribes unto Yisrael, isn't it? And then the northern tribes and the southern. All of it has relevance, Yisrael. There's a kingdom that is set to war against Yisrael. That's why we must pray that Yah raise up the Nobi and the true messengers. Not someone that sit on their ass all day and eat. Not someone that read comic books and folly books and sit around and do nothing. Son, the one that labors in the Torah of Yah. There's no time for nothing else. I don't need no master's degree. I don't want a master's degree. Could have got that. Damn their degrees. We need truth. We need the truth of Yah, Yisrael. We need wise men. Men that are men of Yah that have labored before Yah. And men that are not afraid of the onslaught of this nation. And men that will condemn this wicked nation. And condemn Russia and all of these wicked nations. That rob and steal of the nature of their father. And bring the people down to the dearth of death. It's wrong. And these fools here think that they got, well, we don't want taxes. But Mr. Obama, he's socialist. What is socialism? And yet, if you live in the state of Alaska, where Miss Sarah Palin lived, they have a socialist form of dispensing with equity, everyone, the revenues of the oil, the gas. They do that. But that's not socialism. Everybody share. If you got 10 children, if the check for everyone is $8,000 a month, everybody gets a check. Every citizen of Alaska. Every single citizen of Alaska, they share in the royalties just like the Indians on the reservations with the casinos and all of that. We're stupid. We're a stupid generation. They got this whining woman up and she thinks she's knowledgeable. He's trying to take from the rich and give to the poor. Oh, you silly woman. And so they put a few $1 million in a Jezebel's pocket like that. And she thinks she's rich. She's the Jezebel. You know she's the Jezebel when her little daughter's a flat out whore. You go down to the Appalachians, they look at those little poor babies up there. And they look at the women whose teeth are rotten in their mouth. You don't see them on television. You go down in the hood, you don't see Mary Lou. You don't see Shatana Shakana or Shawakabanka. You go to the Appalachians where they are poor, you don't see Mary Lou Bell. But this little dirty whore, she has a baby right in her mama's house and they serenade her. She gets $20,000 for speaking the game, a little slut. And they guard her. Well, don't talk about she's a whore. She's a damn whore. And yet you will raise hell in Shekinah Wana down there. You go to the Appalachians, a little more Miss Poor Mary Sue, because she's been brought up and crushed under those poverty situations. She got 5 little youngers, her teeth rotten out, and yet she looked despicable. And yet a dirty whore like that did no different than she did it. You raise this whore up and give her $20,000 a shot. You see how stupid this generation is? She get her titties pumped up, get false titties. Well, Miss little Mary Lou Bell up there in Appalachian, she's so poor, her diet is so ill of nutrients. Hell, she looks skinny as a rod. This is a stupid generation. Y'all tear it up. Tear this whorehouse down. And I don't take it back. Tear it up. Tear America up. I can get all those that call themselves Hebrews. We cannot tear this country up. And I, as old folks say, I ain't going to battle with them. Mm-mm. Put it in Yeshua's hands. He will make it all right when the trials of the enemy come against you. Yisrael, Yah will make it all right. He will fight the battle for us all. Don't get discouraged. Don't be afraid. Just put it in your hand. Put it in the Master's, your hands. He's going to bring her down. We will trust in Yah. We will believe our Abba, so Yisrael, hold on, and do not give up, hold on, to the hands of Yahweh, our precious Abba, hold on, Yisrael, hold on to Yah's hands, hold on. Because Yah will make, He will make it all right. He's going to make it all right. I hate what I see in this country, what they have done to the poor. Over 30 years ago, I was making $10 an hour. And you still pay a man $10 an hour. Hyperinflation. We see the drought throughout this nation. Already the price of certain staples, they're just going up, whereby people can't hardly eat. I was reading this morning. I looked at it, I said, what? Greedy bastards. I'm talking about the Walton clan, these greedy bastards. They're greedy bastards. I was listening the other day. I think my Isha was with me. I said, wow. Where about Amazon.com? You find it cheap on Amazon too. Everything is cheap there. Now they're going to implement a system. If you order it this morning, it's there this evening. So corporations like Walmart that never lobbied Congress. When I worked at IBM, when we started there in 1982, IBM never lobbied Congress. They never. One of the few corporations that did not, and so was Walmart. So they're lobbying Congress now, as the bill was passed in this state, under the, we call the guarded prudence of our Honorable Miss Haley, the governor. That Amazon said, look, we will put two factories here. If you will not do things retroactive, go back and see who have ordered here 10 years ago and they have to pay taxes. We put two factories here and we start this year. Last year was the year they started. The stuff we ordered from there was nearly $10,000. That's with equipment and all, that's what it was. That's what we ordered. From Amazon, we spent nearly 10 grand. I'm not worrying about taxes. I'm not going to pay a dime. So what Walmart is doing, when Amazon first came online, 1/4 of the Walmart customers began to shop at Amazon. Now over half of them. So you know what the Waltons are lobbying Congress for? That all these greedy bastards, all of them are worth over $20+ billion. These damn greedy bastards. They are greedy bastards. They are greedy bastards that cannot have enough. To say that all transactions on the internet must pay taxes. Because instead of you going the same grill you buy in Walmart for $69, Amazon you can get it $49 ship free. That's what they're doing. You tell me that's not a greedy dog. When they pay their employees minimum wage, why is it that these rich bastards cannot have a exceeding wage? That's all the money they can. And you tell me that's love? Whereby one family, one woman has $20 billion. She's nasty. She pays her people little or nothing. She is such a rich Jezebel, she doesn't even want them to have insurance. They have labored on their backs and broken. Their homes are shattered because they were faithful. I said to Oximion, I said, you know what? If I was Steve's wife, if I owned that store, now forgive me, I didn't mean to say it like that. I said to him, I said, if I would counsel her, if she asked me, what do I do since he's dead? I said, what I would do, this lady, I've been here 19 years and she's worked with you all those years. She runs the whole store. You don't have $50,000 worth of merchandise here. Tell her, give me $25,000, you take the store. She will be glad to do that. This old woman, nearly 80 years old, 76, 77 years old, who I tried to labor. Your husband is dead. Give that woman that store. They have been faithful there. They have worked all those years. That elderly little old lady, she's been there all those years. That woman, she runs that. I would. And I would say to her, I tell you what, I give you 20 years to pay the $25,000. No interest. You pay me $1,000 a year. You won't even live to that time. That's how I would. If I owned the corporation, if I had gone into that arena, I said to Simeon, I said the people would own the corporation. I would take a 10% or 15% and everything that comes in would be theirs. There would be something for their children. That's the righteous judgment. That's how it should be. If I had $100 million, how will my lifestyle change from $100 million to $200? What can I buy? If I own a corporation, the people would own it. It will make them loyal. They will work. They will be honorable. And they wouldn't steal from me because, no, everyone is watching out for their own time. A system like that is, well, that's socialism. No, that's just caring. That's just kindness. Man, labor in your field. Come on. Just like Jean Valjean says, she says, and you put me on the streets, and now my Cosette, she's sick. And he says to her, lady, whatever it takes, you don't have to work again. I will take care of you. Although he was not responsible for that. And they would talk about how Mr. Valjean, how he has a doctor, he takes care of the people, he gives them fair wages. That's how you do people. You give them an honorable wage. Where mother doesn't have to work from 5 in the morning to 7 in the evening. That's wrong. That's wrong. And that's the nature of this nation, to cause little folks in India to work all day long. A mother all day, she works all day just for enough for some maize. She's not buying pork chop or meat. And we think that we are blessed. If we are blessed, if this is the blessings of Yah, if we call this a blessing, it's a blessing to be able to have a bathroom and a house and all that. That's a blessing. We actually believe that's a blessing. I'll continue in the blessing, the windows of Yah, right? You call that a blessing? You believe that a blessing? That's not a blessing. It's a curse on the people. It is. So Yah's going to bring this whore down. I'm going to revisit this again next year, but don't worry. I got your number, okay? You, my friends, may the riches of Yah rest upon your own. May Yah rock you, all my Octavius and all of my friends, Tayonia, my Zachin, you that are listening, my friend, Yaakov there in Texas. I know you're there, Michaya, Michayala, and Zephaniah. All of you, precious Ahuds, Washington there in Cincinnati, who has been one of the spearheads of this meeting. We appreciate that. We appreciate all your Arahot Mariana there in Indiana. And also our precious friend, Tyweed Stroll there in Indiana. He's a farmer. I've been trying to get him to get down here. He farms. He grows everything organically. He's been into this naturalist type of healthy lifestyle for 30 plus years. Very wise man. So we greet all of you, our friends, and also my enemies. I appreciate you all. I need you. Stay in tune. Keep watching. Keep sending the email because you keep me sharp. I mean that. I appreciate you. I'm not saying that with any despair. I mean that. My enemies keep me right. Because when they purport something, they cause me to get even sharper. So you keep me sharp. Keep doing your job, all right. Yah barak you all on the Shabbat. May the riches of Yah rest upon you all in Yahshua's name. Let us stand to our feet. We're going to turn toward Yerushalayim, the city. As long as we are under the Shabi, we will turn and pray toward the city. In all things, we do barak you, Abba, for this day. For your mercies, your kindness, who are we that you would consider? You would meet us here as the old Kiddush once say, where two or three are gathered in your name, there shall you also be in the midst. And we know, we sense the power of your Ruach, your presence, even in the hearing of our ears to hear what you speak. We ask you to touch the hearts of Yisrael, your people, your nation scattered abroad. Guide us and strengthen us in Yeshua's mighty name. We do barak you for all things. Keep us in this hour as we go from this place and preserve your people, your nation, in Yeshua's mighty name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.